This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Lee Konitz. Conversations on the Improviser's Art. Andy Hamilton. The University of Michigan Press, Ann Arbor. Author's Introduction. The interview form is common in jazz journalism, but a whole book of interviews with a single musician is rare. Lee Konitz is one of the few jazz players who could sustain the reader's interest over so many pages. In conversation, Konitz is thoughtful, combative, reflective, and opinionated, a true thinker with gravitas. Unlike many jazz musicians, he is eager to debate the principles of his art, and isn't afraid to pass frank comments on other musicians, including those he has played with. His total honesty and integrity goes with high critical standards, and he is not interested in a mollifying niceness. He has strong opinions on such issues as intuitive improvisation versus prepared playing, the demands of the group situation, the need for accurate pitch, his inspiration from bebop, and Charlie Parker's compositional approach. But he also reveals a characteristic ambivalence on many of the deepest questions, such as his Jewish identity, the place of the blues in jazz, and jazz's status as an African-American art form, and also concerning such leading figures in the music as Charlie Parker, John Coltrane, Ornette Coleman, and Wayne Shorter. Lee Konitz should be heard in his own words, and in contrast to Quincy Troup's co-written autobiography of Miles Davis and similar efforts, these really are the artist's own words, not an artistic reconstruction. They appear with little editing, though the material has been considerably rearranged to avoid repetition and to produce a more coherent narrative. The interviews were conducted over several years at Konitz's apartment in Cologne, at festivals and gigs in Hull, Coventry, London, Tuscany, and Paris, and by telephone. Extracts have appeared previously in the Wire and Jazz Review. The project began when Tony Harrington and Rob Young of The Wire suggested I subject Lee to an invisible jukebox, a kind of blindfold test where the artist responds to recordings before they are identified, before his set at the Hull Jazz Festival in 1999. At that first meeting, he provided excellent copy, conforming to the stereotypes of grumpy old man and difficult artist. The first disc I played was Anthony Braxton's April, from a tribute to Konitz's teacher Lenny Tristano, and the diatribe that followed, beginning, "It's the worst solo I've ever heard in my life, I think," took me completely aback. This was a man with opinions. Only later did I appreciate that he is also a warm, gentle, and artistically vulnerable soul. After that experience, I persuaded Richard Cook, my original journalistic mentor who got me into jazz writing when he was editor of The Wire, to run two very long Konitz interviews in Jazz Review. By this time, I was getting to know Lee better, and when I turned up to interview him at his apartment in Cologne, he apologized for not having any coffee, but did offer me a whole orange. Eventually, he became more relaxed, and we got to bantering conversation. It's fair to say that Lee has found collaborating on this book challenging, and indeed stressful. It exposes him as an artist, and somehow he couldn't, and I think still can't, believe my assurances that readers would be interested in his opinions and reminiscences at book length. A book, with its promise of permanence, was more threatening to him than the magazine interviews that he's mostly been happy to do, and it took a long time to win him over to the idea. My initial plan was for a co-written autobiography, but on reading the first results, Lee vetoed the project, complaining that it was inauthentic. He was onto something important about that overpopular genre. With interviewers' questions removed, it's hard to see what motivates the subject's remarks. Honesty and candor are lost when the conversation is obscured in this way. The Miles Davis case, it turns out that without comment, Troop added material that was not from his interviews, emphasized how problematic the traditional autobiography is. Even the best-intentioned author has to add material where the interviewer's questions have been cut, and usually does much more. It is a literary form where a persona is constructed. As an alternative, Lee and I settled on the question-and-answer format, with interpolations, though Lee continued to have grave doubts of the kind I've just described. These conversations discuss Konitz's life chronologically, broken up by thematic chapters on improvisation, the instrument, and the material. They inevitably bring out Konitz's ideas from the interviewer's perspective, and in particular reflect my long-standing interest in the process of improvisation and the perennial question of how genuinely spontaneous it can be, which is really the question, what exactly is improvisation? It's evident that the very same question has long preoccupied Lee Konitz. Some musicians will have a hidden agenda. In the case of Miles Davis, Konitz's sometime colleague, almost always. From the 1960s onwards, Davis incorporated the ideas of many musicians that he publicly condemned, in his own way of course, but not wishing to acknowledge the fact. In Konitz's case, I do not believe that there is any hidden agenda. These conversations are frank, and any agenda is explicit. Konitz rightly believes that the Tristano school, and especially its originator, has not got its due with the jazz public, even if it might have from historians of the music, and that it has been much misunderstood. He wants to correct that situation, as also will a new book on Tristano by Yoon-Mi Shim in the present series. Konitz also believes that what he calls prepared playing and a focus on harmonic as opposed to melodic considerations dominate jazz improvisation, and he would like to see that imbalance corrected. Do I, the interviewer, have an agenda? Not that I'm aware of. It's possible that Lee has picked up some of my ideas, but the influence has mostly been the other way round. Lee has been a close collaborator, reading successive drafts of the manuscript and making corrections and additions. I have mostly incorporated the corrections, but on some occasions, where he has had second thoughts about his criticisms of other musicians, I have persuaded him to retain them for the sake of candor. Occasionally, the censoring has worked the other way round. This issue of criticism is a difficult one. Lee is known for his uncompromising artistic vision and exacting critical standards, both for himself and others. His outspoken comments on Anthony Braxton in the Wire interview, which he amplifies here, received particular attention at the time. I approached Braxton via an intermediary to ask whether he would like to talk about Konitz, but understandably perhaps, he declined. The interviews with other musicians were an afterthought that burgeoned, and almost all were conducted as the book was nearing completion. In these interviews, the musicians showed a lot of warmth toward Lee, and their praise helped to give him confidence in the project. Many readers have made suggestions about the organization of the material and pointed out errors and infelicities in the text, but final editing decisions have been between myself and Lee. The original tapes and mini-discs exist, somewhere, if any archive is interested. To return to the question of editing, it is difficult to transfer the feel of speech to the written page, and I have rearranged phrases within sentences and sometimes changed individual words to improve the flow. For example, Konitz said, "I'm not sure if this was the same tour or not, but George Shearing, Al Hibbler, and Lenny were standing by the bus before we got on to leave." I changed this to, "I don't remember if this was the same tour or not, but George Shearing, Al Hibbler, and Lenny were standing by the bus one time before we got on to leave." And Konitz says, on playing Blue Notes, "I can't get away from it. But I'm not exaggerating that feeling, I hope. So I do play Blue Notes occasionally, and hope that they fit into a musical phrase and make some sense. I have changed this to, "I can't get away from it. But I'm not exaggerating that feeling, I hope. I hope that they Blue Notes fit into a musical phrase and make some sense." A number of my brief factual questions have been transformed into Konitz's speech, so that "you joined Kenton in 1952" becomes "I joined Kenton in 1952. On Lee's insistence, "yeah" mostly becomes "yes", on my insistence, etc. etc. mostly becomes, and so on. Obviously, there is much material that I have not included, especially when it repeats other remarks, or where Lee was struggling to express some difficult idea. His memory after all these years is not infallible, and I have done my best to check his reminiscences. Often he would tell me an anecdote, and then some variation on the following conversation would occur. "Can you tell me when that was? You know, I hate that kind of question. Was it the 50s or the 60s? I'd say probably the 60s. Sometimes I could check, but often I could not get a precise date. I should state my background qualifications for writing this book. Lee Konitz has been one of my musical heroes almost from when, as a student, I first fell in love with jazz. Lee Konitz with Warren Marsh, the Atlantic recording from 1955, was one of the first jazz LPs I bought, probably at the record store in St. Andrews in Fife, which later closed while I was on student vacation, unable to help sustain its meager cash flow. It was a surprise to hear Lee, in these conversations, being so self-critical about that almost perfect small group classic. Later I loved Jazz A1, the New York album, An Ideal Scene. I heard him live with Harold Danko in the 1980s, and enjoyed their hilarious Keith Jarrett impersonation. I have for many years been a writer on jazz, improvised music, and modern composition, initially for The Wire and subsequently for Classic CD, Jazz Review, and other publications. I'm a jazz pianist of modest achievements, and it took a lesson with Lee Konitz, reinforced by comments from my friend David Udolf, to make me realize the importance of melody over harmony. This is also the message of Conrad Cork's Harmony with Lego Bricks, an improvisation manual indebted to Konitz's approach, if only I'd had the ears to absorb it. It impressed me that independently these authorities said similar things about my playing. Now that I've finished the book, I hope I can put their thinking into practice. I am grateful to Peter Jones at Edinburgh University for suggesting I combine my day job as philosophy lecturer and my moonlighting as jazz writer into work on the aesthetics of jazz. That's how I got involved in the area of philosophy known as aesthetics or philosophy of art, which I now teach. Teasing out the nature of improvisation is a philosophical matter, so parts of these conversations make up a philosophical dialogue in some sense. At times, Lee commented that he was hoping for some more philosophy, but I think we achieve the kind of cautious but significant resolutions that one hopes for in philosophical debate. Jazz, at the time Konitz was working with Lenny Tristano, was an art music played in nightclubs. For Konitz, it still is, to some extent, and unlike the superstars, he still plays in clubs. Jazz's artistic claims arise in large part from its status as an improvised music, I believe, and intuitive improvisation, of the kind that Konitz practices, is the highest form of improvisation. His career is one of the most consistent examples of commitment to that demanding art. Acknowledgements. I have had outstanding support from the University of Michigan Press. Series editor Lewis Porter deserves a special panegyric for his assistance from the outset on practical as well as scholarly matters. He has helped to make this a much more accurate book, freer of critical clichés. It would have been far inferior without his frequent input and guidance, and invaluable comments and corrections on the penultimate draft. Chris Hebert was a patient and efficient editor who helped to keep the process of production as painless as possible. My thanks also go to the many others who have read the manuscript or offered comments or helped in other ways. Conrad Cork, whose introduction to jazz improvisation harmony with Lego bricks first introduced me to Konitz's method, composer and writer Philip Clark, Safford Chamberlain, whose biography of Warren Marsh and Unsung Cat is inspirational, James Clark for his translation of Frank Wunsch's words from German, Connie Crothers for information about Tristano, Richard Cook for his support as editor of Jazz Review and prudent advice on jazz publishing, Jason Geiger for his knowledge of the publishing world, Jack Goodwin, a tireless scholar of the cool school who has answered many detailed questions, Tony Harrington and Rob Young of The Wire for suggesting and running my first interview with Lee, writers Bill Kirchner, Marcelo Pires, and Brian Priestley for their lengthy scholarly comments on the manuscript under pressure of time, Mark Levinson for his photo of Konitz with Tristano, writer Brian Marley for his stylistic advice and very bad title suggestions, Dan Morgenstern and Tad Hershorn of the Rutgers Institute of Jazz Studies for photographs and information, Evan Parker for his comments and encouragement, Enrico Pirinunzi for insisting that I organize the material more clearly, Rose Rigby of the Sage Gateshead, and Paul Bream for helping to arrange a rare interview with Ornette Coleman, Alan Ross for his comments, Yoon-Mi Shim for her knowledge of Tristano, Alan Shipton for his initial help in getting the project off the ground, Nick Southgate for sage advice on style and presentation, James Tartaglia, especially for his knowledge of the saxophone as an instrument, David Udolf for his insight into improvisation, Emma Webb, who read through a late draft and saved me from many errors, Carl Wojdeck, author of Charlie Parker, his music and life for comments on Parker and Cool Jazz, and Bill Trithel from Discovery Records, Neil Scapelhorn from Ace and Chris Allen of Basho Music. Michael Conklin and Mike Baghetta worked tirelessly on the online discography and on the online mini-biographies and transcriptions, respectively. Sergio Bandera Caram came up with late additions to the discography, which Conrad Cork helped to input. Martin Allison of Durham University Music Department provided technical assistance. Thanks to Oscar Neubauer and Caroline Forbes for their great pictures for the cover and frontispiece, respectively. Ohad Talmor provided at short notice many music examples, including compositions by Lee. As musical director of many recent Project ECTS, he is an important archivist of Lee's work. Francesco Martinelli, of Siena Jazz Archive, Siena, Italy, helped with research and engaged in very helpful discussions on the history of free jazz and free improvisation. I am indebted also to Barga Jazz, Lucca, Italy, for inviting me to the Barga Jazz Festival, where Konitz was performing in 2003. I have benefited greatly from reading Yunmi Shim's prodigiously researched dissertation, Lenny Tristano, 1919-1978, His Life, Music and Teaching, 1999, and from Her Lenny Tristano, His Life and Music, University of Michigan Press 2007, in which some of the citations from Downbeat and other jazz magazines appear. Finally, I am greatly indebted for discussions about Konitz's music with musicians who have worked with him, and above all, to Joe Lovano for his foreword. I apologize to those musicians who have worked with Konitz, but whom I was unable to contact for a contribution, either because I did not know how to get in touch, or due to pressure of time and space. I could have assembled a further cast, as articulate and informative as the one assembled here. In particular, I am sorry that I could not conduct or for space reasons include interviews with Jerry Allen, Derek Bailey, Chick Corea, Connie Crothers, Don Ferrara, Charlie Hayden, Bengt Hallberg, Jim Hall, Peter Ein, Charles Lloyd, Jackie McLean, Brad Meldo, Bob Mover, Billy Taylor, Clark Terry, and Mark Turner. Last but not least, of course, I must thank Lee Konitz for his patient responses to my incessant questioning, his interest and commitment in pursuing philosophical questions about his art, his hard work in checking the various drafts of the manuscript, and of course, his musical inspiration. I am grateful to the editors of The Wire and Jazz Review for their permission to quote extensively from material that has appeared in their publications. While every attempt has been made to contact relevant copyright holders, any omissions are regretted, and anyone affected is invited to contact the University of Michigan Press. Andy Hamilton. Foreword. Andy Hamilton and Lee Konitz have put together an extraordinary retrospective with interviews and commentary on the life of one of jazz music's most beloved and individual voices. Lee Konitz has contributed to the development of this music's life cycles from his emergence onto the scene in the 1940s to the explorations of today. Lee has always tried to be the most creative and spontaneous of improvisers, and has influenced all of us in the most positive way with his passionate and free-flowing approach to standard songs as well as more exploratory forms. In this collection of conversations, Lee gives insightful accounts and critiques of mentors and colleagues. He discusses his early family life growing up in Chicago, meeting, studying, and playing with Lenny Tristano, moving to New York, working with Miles Davis, and contributing to the influential recording birth of The Cool with Gil Evans, John Lewis, and Jerry Mulligan, joining Stan Kenton, as well as his associations with Lester Young, Charlie Parker, Warren Marsh, Charles Mingus, and other major musicians. We come to discover why he plays the way he does, and what has driven him through the years in the world of music. Lee has led a full life as an innovative improviser in the international spotlight, and he is well respected and revered around the world by musicians and fans. He has taught generations of musicians he's worked with through the years, just being himself and giving all he can with generosity and love. As an alto saxophonist, he's developed his own sound and approach, different from Charlie Parker's. I am truly honored to know him and feel blessed to have him as a teacher, mentor, and friend. After my early listening to his records, I've had the great fortune to experience at first hand, or should I say first ear, his sound, feeling, and ideas on many occasions since the mid-1970s when I moved to New York City. To be in a room with his sound is an inspiration, but to follow his lines on the tune he's exploring taught me so much about how to try and put it all together for myself. Your playing develops from everything you embrace, and Lee's clarity and subtleties, which come through on every phrase, gave me some beautiful things to reach for. In 1991, Lee joined Charlie Hayden, Bill Frisell, Paul Motian, and myself for a quintet session entitled Paul Motian on Broadway Volume 3, JMT Records. This was the first time Lee and I actually played together, sharing melodies and improvising collectively throughout the recording. It is one of the most creative sessions of standard songs I've been a part of, and I am very proud of its success. Some years later, in the mid-1990s, the group did a 3-week European festival tour with Mark Johnson on bass instead of Charlie. It was great to travel and play with Paul and Lee on this tour, given their long crazy history together that went back to the Lenny Tristano days in the 1950s. I think it was the first time they toured together. It was fun and challenging to play with these different personalities night after night at such a high level of musicianship. The magic in jazz is all about communication and sharing ideas spontaneously within an ensemble. When it's happening, there's nothing like it in music. We had some incredible moments during that tour, and I learned a lot about who I am and what I'm trying to do in music and on my horn. Lee's love and dedication have driven his career, and given all of us who know him the confidence to create our own space in this amazing world of music we live in. Enjoy meeting Lee Konitz in this book on a personal level, as honest and alive as his music. Sounds and Feelings. Joe Lovano. Prologue. I'm writing this after a trip to Vienna, and while I was there, I had the opportunity to hear an Austrian tenor player, 15 years old, who really played the instrument very well and wowed the audience with his expertise. And a few days ago I heard an Italian alto player of the same age who was really unbelievably accomplished, instrumentally and musically, and he really got the audience shouting approval. When I was 15 years old I was playing, but no one had really inspired me like these two guys have obviously been inspired. These two talented people were not aware as yet of a true musical statement without the sensationalism, something they will learn, we hope. I got my inspiration from Lenny Tristano, and also Lester Young and Charlie Parker. Tristano demonstrated for me a way to play that went deeper than virtuoso musicality. As John Updike wrote, virtuosity can seem a distraction, as when you find that you are thinking about how great the musician is instead of listening to the music. I never wowed an audience in my whole life like those two young players did, so I can't help but feel I missed something. But in a more modest way, I've been able to continue playing, in private and in public, with occasional comments from people after a concert, telling me they like the way I played through the years. So I am grateful to find a place in the improvising neighborhood, and can only wish those two virtuosi a good and real musical life. Mike Swearin, who writes a column for the Herald Tribune every couple of weeks, just wrote a great piece headlined Murdering the Silence with Bad Music, a quote from Joseph Conrad. While in Vienna, I went to the cemetery and saw Beethoven's tomb next to Schubert's, next to Brahms's, in a small area. They replaced the silence with beautiful music. Jazz is often too concerned with exhibitionism and emoting non-stop, but there have been many beautiful players. Coleman Hawkins's Body and Soul, Lester Young's Lady Be Good with Basie, Charlie Parker's Don't Blame Me, Warren Marsh with Paul Chambers and Paul Motian, four beautiful trio tunes on Atlantic Records, Wayne Shorter at the Plug Nickel with Miles, and many others. Keith Jarrett, Brad Meldo, Chick Corea, Bill Evans, Lenny Tristano, and so on. That's the tradition and the intention that hopefully will get to these young players. I would like to say how much I appreciate working on this project with Andy Hamilton. Left to my own efforts, I would not have written it down or up. Andy, with great interest and patience, was willing to meet with me a number of times with lists of questions. For instance, we spent a few days together as adjudicators at a big band contest for arrangers in Barga in Italy, and had a few opportunities for discussion. I also want to thank all my musical colleagues for their great words in the short interviews Andy did. Gradually, over many months and years, Andy organized the material. I read it and changed many things and added much. The last step after reading and deleting and adding and rereading and redeleting and re-adding a few more times is to get the book published and released. I welcome the opportunity to go public with this musical part of my life for the people who like my playing. I hope they appreciate the music a little more after getting a look behind the scene, we hope that there are a few insightful moments ahead. With appreciation for your support, Lee Konitz. Brief biography of Lee Konitz. Lee Konitz is one of the most original and distinctive alto saxophonists in the history of jazz. With Sonny Rollins, Max Roach, and a few others, he is one of the surviving master improvisers of the bebop generation. But his apprenticeship to bebop was indirect, and he has carved out an uncompromising solo career guided by a singular artistic vision. He seeks out challenging situations and strives for perfection in the momentary art of improvisation. He is unerringly self-critical and always stretches himself to do the best work possible. Though Konitz is a highly reflective musician, what he plays is intuitive, the product of an intensely emotional sensibility. It's striking how ingenious Konitz has been in creating novel contexts for the traditional approach of theme and variations that he follows. In albums such as Piecemeal or Duets from the 1960s, the solo album Lonely from the 1970s, right up to the recent duo album with drummer Matt Wilson, Gone with Wind, the saxophonist has been concerned to develop new formats for improvisation. Konitz was born on October 13, 1927, in Chicago, of Austrian-Russian Jewish parents. At the age of 11, he picked up his first instrument, the clarinet, on which he received classical lessons before switching to tenor and then alto saxophone. In 1943, he met the decisive personal and musical influence of his life, the blind teacher and pianist Lenny Trastano. He joined Claude Thornhill's orchestra 1947-48 and made his first recordings with them. The band, which employed Gil Evans as arranger, was an important precursor of Miles Davis's Nonet, later known as the Birth of the Cool Band 1948-50, which Konitz went on to join. It is the latter association for which he remains best known, and he is generally regarded, with Trastano and Miles Davis, as one of the architects of the cool style in modern jazz. Konitz's greatest influence was his still-neglected teacher Lenny Trastano, but he also thoroughly assimilated the heritage of saxophonists Charlie Parker and Lester Young. Konitz's partnerships with Trastano and with his fellow pupil, the totally individual tenor saxophonist Warren Marsh, were the defining ones of his career. But although Lenny Trastano was a formative influence on Konitz, one shouldn't assume that he was working on a tabula rasa. Although immature by his later standards, Konitz's earliest commercially recorded solos with the Thornhill Orchestra in 1947 illustrate that he was already developing a unique jazz style characterized by a highly original tone with a purity unusual in jazz. An excellent example of Konitz's early style is the solo on the 1949 recording of Subconsciously with Trastano. An original Konitz line on the chord changes to "What is this thing called love?" Trastano often had his students write original lines over standards, but the education also included experiments in free jazz. As leader, Konitz recorded with Warren Marsh, 1949, and he worked with the Lenny Trastano Quartet, 1954-55, recording at the Sing Song Room of the Confucius Restaurant in New York. A period in Stan Kenton's band, 1952-53, extended his experience and range of playing contexts, and periodically he has returned to larger ensembles. But his most original and challenging work has been in smaller groups, where improvisational freedom can be given full rein. Konitz is the spontaneous improviser par excellence, constantly finding inspiration in the Tin Pan Alley songs, later known as standards, that since the 1920s have continued to attract jazz musicians. Throughout his career, Konitz has composed, often, but not always, on the chords of standards. Konitz's career was at its lowest ebb commercially, though not artistically, in the early 1960s when he lived in California. In 1961, however, he recorded Motion with John Coltrane's drummer Elvin Jones, one of his finest albums. After his spell in California, he returned to New York in 1964 to appear at the Half Note with Trastano. At a memorial concert to Charlie Parker in Carnegie Hall in 1965, he performed a remarkable solo tribute, Blues for Bird. In 1967, he recorded his duets album, a series of duos with Joe Henderson, Richie Kamuka, Jim Hall, Ray Nance, Elvin Jones, and others, a format that later became a speciality. Later duos were with Sal Mosca, 1971, Red Mitchell, Hal Galper, 1974-75, Jimmy Giuffre, Marshall Solal, 1978-1980, Carl Berger, 1979, Michel Petrucciani, 1982, and Harold Danko, 1984. In the 1970s, Konitz was sometimes reunited with Warren Marsh, and in 1975 he returned to the nonet format, which was compared, somewhat inaccurately, with the birth of the cool band. For much of the time since the mid-1960s, Konitz has lived and worked in Europe. He also became popular in Japan. He recorded in Germany with Attila Zoller and Albert Mangelsdorf, 1968, and in Italy with Marshall Solal, 1968, and Enrico Rava, 1968. He can be heard on Mingus at Town Hall, 1972. He recorded with Dave Brubeck and Anthony Braxton, with Andrew Hill, and with Warren Marsh and Bill Evans, 1977. He devoted an album to the tenor, 1977, played with Paul Blay, and appeared in Europe with Shelley Mann. He rejoined Charles Mingus, with whom he had worked in the 1950s, in 1978, and played in a duo with Gil Evans in 1980, eventually releasing two albums, Heroes and Anti-Heroes. In recent years he has again played more in the United States, and achieved further recognition there. Konitz keeps an apartment in New York, but in 1997 he married a native of Cologne, and since then he has lived there most of the time, in a flat near the city center. As he moves into his later 70s, Konitz is working with much younger players such as Matt Wilson, Joey Barron, and Greg Cohen, as well as many European players. In his artistic Indian summer, Konitz's achievement is becoming more widely recognized. 1. Early life and career. We begin with Lee's reminiscences of his upbringing in Chicago in the 1930s, and the influence of his Jewish family background. This material comes from my first extended interview with him, at his apartment in Cologne in 2000. He was a little reticent at first in talking about his parents, but there was a lot of feeling not far from the surface. He is grateful to them for encouraging his love of music, but they did not really understand jazz, and his love for it reinforced his alienation from traditional, observant Jewish culture. The effect of assimilation and the melting pot on the first generation in a new country meant that Konitz's attitude to traditional Jewish culture remained ambivalent, as it did with other Jewish jazz musicians and the great songwriters he most loves. John Zorn's short interview in this chapter gives a hint of the minefield of identity politics. I have a few biographical questions and then some musical ones. It's a bit boring, but we'll start at the beginning. Well, I hate to think of my life as being boring. I mean starting at the beginning, and it might be boring for you to have to answer questions you've answered before. Hopefully, with a little bit of different insight, each time is a little different. I don't have a lurid personal story to tell. My niece in Chicago just gave me a review of a recent book on Chet Baker by James Gavin. And they Gavin tear him apart. I don't have any of that dramatic stuff. My pot smoking would take up a couple of pages at best. My father was Austrian, my mother was from Russia. They came to the United States in the first decade of the last century. They landed eventually on the north side of Chicago, and the family moved into a few different places in that area. For some reason I can't tell you too much about that, we never talked about it. I guess they emigrated to get a better life. My grandfather, my mother's father, was here in Chicago already, I believe. I don't know why my father came to Chicago, I don't know that he had any family here. My parents met each other and married in Chicago. They always lived there. You have an unusual surname. I got a tax statement for a Konitz with an S one time in New York. He's a bass player that lives in Long Island somewhere. Then there's the poet Stanley Kunitz. And someone contacted me whose name was Konitz. I told my two sons who are not married that they would be the end of the Konitz name, and they were visibly unmoved by that, as I was. I never liked the name too much. Both of my brothers changed their name to K. They were both businessmen and felt they could negotiate things better that way without having to spell their name every time. A lot of Jewish jazz musicians changed their names, Shorty Rogers, Steve Lacy, and so on. But you never thought of doing that. I was named Leon, and it became Lee over the years. And when I was with the Stan Kenton Band, a radio announcer introduced me as Lee Coates, and from then on in the band, I was Coates. I kinda liked it. But when I left the band, it didn't stick. Did you have a happy childhood? Well, my two brothers were 6 and 9 years older than me, and they were interested in many things that I wasn't able to join in. I couldn't play baseball with them. They were kind of stuck with me, having to take care of me while my parents worked, so I became like a ball and chain to them, and that was not a happy situation. I paid my dues for being the youngest one. But otherwise, the family got along pretty well. Was it a struggle for your parents to make ends meet? Yeah, they had to work hard all the time. My father had a laundry and cleaning establishment, and we were living in the back. I remember the care packages for poor families we got at Christmas time, sweaters and things. But otherwise, there wasn't a feeling of being without so much, and I appreciated that. My parents encouraged me to pursue my instrumental interests. They didn't encourage me to finish all of my schooling, which was unfortunate, I felt. I was able to work as a musician at an early age, and somehow that got me out of school. In my sophomore year, the second year of high school, I went on the road with some friends, and then for some reason which I really can't remember, my parents didn't encourage me to go back. I was 16. When I was 18 or 19, I spent a short time at Roosevelt College as a special student. I hadn't graduated formally from high school, and I took what they call college preparatory courses, like political science, sociology, and so on. What music did your parents like? Classical music and opera, but they didn't really listen to it much, except the Saturday afternoon opera programs on the radio. There weren't a lot of records in the house, except the ones that I collected. My parents had a natural instinct to sing, but there was no musical cultivation, so to speak, in the family. That all came from outside. My older brothers were not really interested in jazz, they just liked the popular music of the day. My oldest brother was an amateur comedian, and he liked to burst into spontaneous song, but there was nothing more to it than that. So what in your upbringing brought you to jazz? At 11, I got a clarinet, because I was listening to Benny Goodman on the radio, and various other dance bands such as Glenn Miller and Count Basie. Benny Goodman was especially impressive to me. He was my first influence. So I guess I was listening before I was 11. I heard the music on the radio, and also friends turned me on to it. It was very exciting to me, listening to the radio under the covers late at night. So you didn't play an instrument till you were 11? No, I was just a whistler. I've never been able to figure this one out in retrospect. My parents very graciously got me a clarinet at the Boston department store in Chicago, and included with the clarinet, I got a substantial coupon book with free lessons. Incidentally, I've often wondered if there's a Chicago department store in Boston. So, a buffet clarinet, a name clarinet, and many weeks of lessons with a very fine teacher who Johnny Griffin and Eddie Harris also studied with, Lou Honig was his name. A very lucky situation for me. I kept handing the coupons to this nice man each week for a while, and then I paid a small fee for succeeding lessons. These lasted, I think, a couple of years. I studied classical clarinet and formed a clarinet embouchure, a very rigid kind of muscle formation. Lou Honig was just teaching me the technique of the instrument. It had nothing to do with jazz as such. We did exercises and little pieces from one of the basic clarinet books. He was a dance band player, a club date musician. He played trumpet and saxophone, and was technically able to adjust to these different instruments. He was quite a well-schooled guy. The following year, when I was 12, I got a tenor saxophone and studied it with him. At some point after that, I studied with a man named Santi Runyon, who got a little more into the music, playing some more jazzy etudes and things, but still basically out of books. And then at some point, I was already able to work, because of the war period. I met Lenny Tristano, and he really opened the door to the possibilities of this music for me, and I am truly grateful for what he did for me, and for many others. Your parents didn't have a piano. No, they never did. What did they make of your musical aspirations? My parents were pleased that I was interested, and they made a sacrifice to get me the instrument. My father loved Artie Shaw's Concerto for Clarinet, but they had no real knowledge of jazz. As the youngest of three sons, especially, I wasn't able to communicate with my dear mother and father, who had to work hard to provide for us. My interest in music was encouraged but not understood, so I couldn't share this most important part of my youth with them, making me feel like an outsider at home. But I always appreciated their encouragement. They were very good, basic people. Really, they were happy that I was doing something I liked, and that I was already earning money at it. They didn't give me the classic, become a doctor or lawyer alternative of the Jewish family, and probably most families. So you respected them for that. I really appreciated it. I was left alone very much, so I could practice my craft. I didn't know about art as yet. I left home at the age of 20 to join the Claude Thornhill Band, and went to New York. I remember coming back and playing with Warren Marsh and Tristano at a club in Chicago much later, and my parents came to listen. I couldn't imagine what they would be getting out of it. They never really commented. They got the first few touches of my being famous. A few times they came to hear me when I was playing in Chicago. I think they were proud that I had found a way of life. And I appreciated that. My oldest brother, the natural singer who had a great sense of humor, was kind of a hero in some way. But though my brothers and I kept in touch, we didn't really have that much to talk about. Once in a while we talked, but it wasn't that close a relationship. My eldest brother died of a stroke at the age of 80, and so did my other brother at the age of 83. I was always envious of families that were musically involved. I just read this piece on Richard Rogers, talking about how the parents fought bitterly, but they always went to the theater and bought sheet music, and stayed around the piano and sang. And when they found out Richard was talented, they encouraged him. And of course the Joneses and the Heaths were the same. My five children never became professional musicians. The oldest boy was kind of interested and showed real talent, but he didn't develop his ability. He works hard for a living, installing heating and air conditioning systems. I never conceived of working that hard. I really respect his decision. He still has fun with music, as do my other children. Was jazz a way of rebelling against your background? In some ways. There was something in-groupish about the Jewish people that I saw that I didn't like. There was always that word Gentile, which I hated. In my father's laundry and cleaning establishment, black ladies did ironing and things in the shop and they were referred to as Schwarzes. I didn't like that before I knew why, exactly. It just felt like us and them, and I didn't like that feeling, and I still don't. Was Jewish music an influence on you? I never was fond of that music. I heard it. I went to Hebrew school for a short period of time and went to the synagogue sometime, and I never enjoyed that too much. It felt too otherworldly. And my parents were otherworldly, though they weren't strict religiously. They just observed high holidays and some of the dietary things. You don't mix milk and meat, and some preparations I don't really recall. When my parents spoke Yiddish, I was a little bit ashamed that they weren't speaking English more. So I kind of missed out on that cultural situation. I tried, but it didn't really work. To jump up to the present time, I made a record in May 2000, for John Zorn's label, Zodic. There's a Star of David on the liner package. He was talking about bringing out my Jewishness. That's one of his missions. He sent me some of the records on his label, and there was a solo record of Steve Lacy, a very nice record. I read the liner notes, and Steve confessed to being a closet Jew. I didn't really know that. And so he felt relieved that it finally came out. I was thinking, is that gonna be what I'm gonna do? Let's see, my father's name was Abraham, and my mother's name was Anna, etc., etc. So we made the record and listened to it later, and John said, I think we'll put this in the jazz section, do the Jewish one next time. So it appeared on the DIW label as some new stuff. Does he want you to do a klezmer record? No, he just wants me to do what I would conceive of as being Jewish music, and I don't really know about that. On one occasion, someone on the bandstand suggested a monk tune, and I quickly remarked that I only play Jewish composers, meaning George Gershwin, Jerome Kern, etc. That's Jewish music to me, that's what I prefer to play. Without Jerome Kern, I might be in the laundry business. When I talked about this with Paul Blay, he said he'd concealed his ethnicity from you. Like hell he did. He's Jewish all over. When you're Jewish, it's hard to keep it a secret. Steve Lacy did. But I don't broadcast it. If someone asks, I tell them my heritage, but I don't practice Jewishness, except with the jokes. Interview with John Zorn. Born in New York's East Village in 1953 and raised there, John Zorn is a unique creative figure whose work straddles many scenes, hardcore rock with cult bands Painkiller and Naked City, jazz with News for Lulu and Spy vs. Spy, and Jewish music through his two books of Masada compositions. As an improviser, he has performed with every major figure on the international scene, and his legendary game pieces are performed regularly by renegade groupings. His classical concert music is performed by ensembles worldwide, and he has scored music for many independent and underground films. A firm supporter of the music and musicians he believes in, he started the Zodic label in 1995 and has edited and published a volume of musicians' writings, Arcana. Lee is one of my very favorite saxophonists. I love his tunes, and coming up as a young sax player, I memorized all of them, playing to his records every day for 10 years. His compositions are some of the most beautiful, complex melodies in jazz history. Lee has a very independent creative mind and doesn't take any shit. I respect that. Lenny Tristano was a Svengali in many respects, with a very specific agenda, but Lee was one of the few that broke free and went their own way. Here's a guy that blew Charlie Parker away. For 60 years, this guy's been kicking ass on the saxophone. The sound he had when he was with the Kenton Band in the early 50s, when he used that hard reed, I don't think anyone ever sounded like that on the saxophone. What a tone, what an incredible sound. Certain notes were so intense they became almost visual to me. So when I started the Great Jewish Music Series on Zodic to celebrate the contributions of Jewish composers to world culture, we did the music of Burt Bacharach, Serge Gainsbourg, Mark Bolan. Lee was one of the first people I thought of. The scale used in his tune Carrie's Trance always had a real Jewish feel to me. Eventually, I dismissed the idea of doing a project of other musicians doing Konitz tunes and asked Lee directly if he was interested in making a CD of Jewish material. Lee wanted to make a CD of originals with original chord changes. What he said to me broke my heart, that when he records for other labels, they never want his originals, they just want him to do standards. What I was hoping for, I guess, was a CD of tunes that dealt with Jewishness in some way, perhaps like Carrie's Trance. Other musicians of his generation, Steve Lacy and Bora Bergman, for example, made beautiful recordings for Zodic, dealing with Jewish scales, themes, and subject matter. What Lee brought in was a fabulous batch of new tunes, but they just didn't feel particularly Jewish, so with Lee's approval, we transferred it to the Japanese DIW label, and it was released as some new stuff. If Lee ever wanted to revisit the Jewish challenge, I would be delighted. He's one of my all-time heroes. It's important to realize that Konitz started playing saxophone before the advent of bebop in 1945. His earliest influences, therefore, were musicians from the swing era. He now discusses their influence from before the time he met Lenny Tristano and listened to Charlie Parker, leaving for later discussion his principal mentor from that era, Lester Young. Apart from Benny Goodman, which clarinet players did you admire? I admired Artie Shaw and Lester Young. I was very sorry that Artie decided to give up playing completely. He actually tried to absorb bebop, and he did a much better job than Benny Goodman, who just made a half-assed attempt and didn't really get it. I loved Artie Shaw's bands and his playing. I had preferred Benny Goodman early on for his sound. But as I continued to listen over the years, I pushed Benny aside. He was a great clarinet player, but Artie was a great musician. On Artie's later recordings with Al Cohn and Zoot Sims and Shorty Rogers arrangements or whatever, he's really playing a different kind of line. It's not somehow as sensational as he was before with all the high notes, but it was very musical. What made you change from clarinet to tenor sax and later alto? It was partly pragmatic. In order to work in a band, you had to play the saxophone. When I picked up the saxophone, I used the clarinet embouchure. I had a very tight jaw musculature to get that sound, and I just brought that to the saxophone. I think that's partly responsible for the sound I ended up with. I preferred that somehow. Over the years, I've tried every sort of embouchure to loosen up. I haven't kept up clarinet at all. I used it as what they call a double in Claude Thornhill's band, and that was about the end of it. I went from tenor sax to alto because I had an offer to play in a nightclub in a show band, and they needed an alto player. I also worked with Jimmy Dale's big band. I liked the alto sound, and it became my instrumental choice. It's been said that in the early 40s, the Chicago scene was depressed because the major players had moved to New York. No, it was very active. There were many places to play. As a teenager, I was playing in cocktail lounges and ballrooms. It was a very exciting time for me. The leading player at that time was Roy Eldridge. He was the hero. He played at the Three Deuces, but I never heard him there. I was still too young to get in. But sneaking in, I remember hearing trumpeter Red Allen, alto saxophonist Pete Brown, Don Stovall, trombonist J.C. Higginbotham. That was very exciting. I think Roy was one of the hottest trumpet players, one of the hottest players of any instrument in all of jazz. I loved his sound, his feeling, the note selections. Basically, he was playing as a singer, a great opera singer. I loved the records he made with Chewberry, like Body and Soul, and I Can't Believe That You're in Love with Me, with Benny Carter and Coleman Hawkins. And with Artie Shaw's band, and with Gene Krupa, After You've Gone and Let Me Off Uptown, just everything he played was great. After hearing him, Chet Baker with that pretty sound was hard to take, and Miles too at the beginning, when he was playing that very subtle vibrato-less sound. I mean, Roy let it all hang out. A great emotional vibrato, and a great buzz when you wanted it. I just had a nice recollection of working in a club in New York in the 1950s with my Tristano student quartet, Ronnie Ball, Peter Eind, Dick Scott, opposite Louis Armstrong. What a bill, the Lee Konitz group opening for Pops. During his act, he was singing a song that was anti-bebop, making fun of it to the crowd of Louis Armstrong admirers, and I didn't appreciate that. But Trummy Young, the trombone player, invited me during the break into the back room with Louis, bless their hearts. Trummy took out a cigar-sized joint and passed it around. I tell you, that was some powerful shit. I had trouble finding the bandstand afterwards. During that set, I looked around the room after playing one of my masterful extemporizations, Laughs, and there was Louis leaning on the railing listening to us. Don't know if he loved it, but there he was. He might just have been standing there looking at a pretty lady. You never know with these guys. So it was a generation of swing players that influenced you before you met Tristano. Yes. Johnny Hodges was a definitive influence on ballad playing per se. Phil Woods and John Coltrane loved Johnny. His hot playing, which was virtuosic, wasn't really my favorite concept, but his ballad playing had a very deep effect on me. Every saxophone player loved Johnny Hodges, till Charlie Parker came along and they dropped him. I loved the way he played so sweetly. Now I find it a little schmaltzy, but I still love it. It was just so beautifully done. He was able to glissando down an octave, on Passion Flower, he did that, at the end of the bridge. And that's very difficult. It's impossible. I've been trying to do that since then, and I still can't do it smoothly. That was a real hallmark of his style. Yes. When I did that tribute to him recently for the Jazz at Lincoln Center Hall of Fame in New York 2005, I played these ballads, but I never bent the notes. I've heard Phil Woods play with the kind of bends that Johnny Hodges used, but I didn't want to do an imitation of him. I just wanted to play a very straight, sweet-sounding melody. Do you ever bend notes? Not if I can help it. It doesn't appeal to me. But I do have a feeling sometimes to slide around a little bit. As well as Johnny Hodges, Benny Carter was an inspiration also, especially one record that he made on Commodore, I Can't Believe That You're in Love with Me, with Coleman Hawkins and Roy Eldridge. He was thought of as a cool player. Yes, very much so. No one really thought of that term then, but he definitely was. A lot of times he sounded a bit schmaltzy to me, in the sense of not having the most sophisticated phrases or developments. I always admired him though, as a great saxophone player, and that one solo, I'm sure there are other ones, but I didn't know all of his records, really got it. It wasn't a long solo. If we start with the premise that Charlie Parker turned the whole scene around with 16 bars on Whispering, which Groove and High was based on, it doesn't take that much to make a point. Willie Smith has also been mentioned as an influence on you. He was a fine player who was playing, I was told, absolutely written, out solos. He never improvised in those contexts. But he did it very well, and I liked his sound. He sounded a little out of place in the jazz at the Philharmonic setting with Bird. Many people have said it's a good discipline to say what you can in 16 or 32 bars on a 3-minute record, but it is a limitation. I agree with that. I admire Sonny Rollins being able to play for 45 minutes and keep it interesting and high-spirited, but 16 bars is often enough. My longest solo is probably on the solo record I made. I did a 40-minute version of The Song Is You, and then tried one other tune, Cherokee, for 20 or 30 minutes. Eventually the 40-minute version appeared on CD. One of Konitz's first jobs in 1945 was with Jerry Wald's band in the sax section, not taking solos, in the Chicago area and on the road. When Konitz left Wald, he worked in the Chicago area with pianist Lloyd Lifton, with whom he made his earliest known non-commercial recording. He also played in Teddy Powell's orchestra, in which, as he explains, he took the chair of tenor saxophonist Charlie Ventura, whose Bop for the People band later in the decade tried to popularize bebop. I was with Jerry Wald's band just a couple of months. Jerry was a very fine clarinet player in the style of Artie Shaw. It was a very good dance band, nice and loose, and I played third alto. I didn't play any solos. I wore a uniform. I was able to read and get a blend in the section, and just enjoy some good players. Also that year I played a month with a very fine band, Teddy Powell's. I actually took Charlie Ventura's chair on tenor, and really was not qualified to do that then. I used to hear Charlie Ventura with Gene Krupa's band. He played the altissimo, highest register very well, in nice augmented chord arpeggios. He played very passionately. His concept was a little bit in between Someplace I Didn't Love, elements of Ben Webster, Lester and Bird, but the final mixture was, I guess, sentimental ballads and virtuosic playing on faster tempos. When I took his chair in Teddy Powell's band, as a teenager, his parts had chord symbols written in concert key. I had very little experience with chords, much less written in another key. I had to play the tenor and the bass clarinet, which I wasn't that familiar with. The first time I played a solo, Teddy banged his head on the wall of the stage in disbelief or whatever. There was a nail in the wall, served him right. A lot of people had left the band for some reason, so I guess they hurriedly got replacements. But it was an experience to play with a good dance band. Jimmy Dale had a band of Chicago musicians, including Gene Ammons and Lou Levy. The only gigs I remember were in the Pershing Ballroom. He jumped up and down in front of the band, pretending to be Lionel Hampton. Harold Fox was his real name. He ran a tailor's business, making band uniforms. He was really a club date trumpet player, a nice guy and a good friend, but a little bit out to lunch. By this time Konitz was studying with Lenny Tristano, so before discussing his career with the Claude Thornhill Orchestra, and then Miles Davis, it's necessary to backtrack a little to discuss the beginnings of Tristano's dominant musical and philosophical influence on him. 2. Formative Influences. Lenny Tristano, Charlie Parker, and Lester Young. Konitz's totally individual style on alto saxophone came out of a mixture of influences, whose exact proportions are hard to determine. He says later in this chapter that he was already studying with Tristano when he first heard Charlie Parker, and the same may be true of his first hearing Lester Young. But though Konitz avers that Tristano steered him away from the influence of the bebop master, and the consensus is that Konitz's style is independent of Parker's, in fact, his influence on Konitz's tone runs deep, as Gunther Schuller argues in his interview at the start of Chapter 8. Even if Konitz is not in any sense a disciple, his distinctive sound is a modern jazz saxophone tone that comes out of Parker. Nonetheless, the influence of Parker and Lester Young was filtered through the teaching of Lenny Tristano, a very dominant musical personality. Tristano was one of jazz's most remarkable innovators. A charismatic influence on a generation of mainly white players, the blind pianist had a remarkable technique and fertile musical imagination. His work was respected by many leading figures, including Charlie Parker. Tristano was widely recognized as a compelling teacher, who demonstrated, against the accepted view up to that time, that jazz improvisation could be taught. His name is a constant point of reference throughout these conversations. Konitz described him as a musician philosopher, and the school of young musicians around Tristano became known as a cooler modern jazz alternative to bebop, or at least as an extension of it. Tristano was born in Chicago in 1919. He had weak sight at birth and was completely blind before being placed at the age of 15 in the Illinois School for the Blind. There he learned piano and also clarinet, alto and tenor sax, guitar, trumpet, and drums. He began to work professionally at age 12 and entered the American Conservatory of Music in Chicago, becoming a highly schooled musician with a grounding in classical music as well as jazz. By 1943, he was teaching at the Christensen School of Popular Music in Chicago. His strongly held ideas on jazz improvisation, especially the need for rigorous construction over the creation of overt emotional effect, became the basis of the Tristano School. But although Tristano and Charlie Parker had a strong mutual admiration, critics soon began to contrast the former's music as more cool and cerebral. Konitz's reminiscences paint a portrait of Tristano as a magnetic but troubled personality, whose influence was a source of the saxophonist's great originality, but which he eventually had to escape at some personal cost and with unresolved tensions. The studies with Tristano are discussed in this chapter, followed by discussion of the influence of Lester Young and Charlie Parker. Konitz's participation in Tristano's groups and recordings and his analysis of the pianist's music appear in the next chapter. I first met Lenny when I was playing with a dance band at a ballroom on the southwest side of Chicago. A friend of mine, a pianist named Joe Lipuma, was working at a pub across the street, the Winkin Pub. When I finished working, I went over to hear him. The second band there was a kind of Mexican band, and Tristano was playing with them. I sat in and spoke with him. What struck you about his playing at that point? He was playing a lot of locked hands things, in the style of Milt Buckner, very interesting lines, really a very special conception. It didn't quite fit the Latin context, but it was very hip. When Tristano first heard you, you were playing tenor. He recollected that your playing was horrible, atrocious. He told you, forget the tenor, play alto. I don't remember him suggesting that. To criticize me so strongly because I wasn't cultivated yet, doesn't sound right to me. Maybe it's a way of saying what a good teacher he was, to take a completely untalented guy. Whether he really made that quote or not is another question. I think a lot of these interviews in the 1940s and 1950s, which quote you or Charlie Parker for instance, put words into the musician's mouth. As you say, if you were playing so horribly, why would he be interested in teaching you? Well, he was earning his living from teaching, though I presume I was one of his earliest pupils. I was already improvising, without much knowledge. That's what he liked about me, the fact that I was an improviser. The way I was playing then could be closer to the way a free improviser would play. I wasn't sophisticated about changes or things like that. What did studying with Tristano involve? It was very basic theory. We went through the scales and chord sequences.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.